Okay. Alrighty, so let's go ahead and get started. First of all, thank you for taking time out of your very busy day to attend today's presentation. I know you have a busy schedule, so thank you very much. Okay, so my name is Abraham Hernandez. You can call me Abe. And today we're going to be discussing a topic that is controversial and has two sides to it. So from the get-go, I'd like for everyone in the room to, as we go through this discussion, to think of both sides of where you personally stand on it. And then we'll have some group discussions, some brainstorming activities, etc., on that discussion. Now, before we really get started, I want to address some of the layouts of the room just so everyone knows at least where the bathrooms are at. Towards the left, there's an exit. You go downstairs, a bathroom to your left. Feel free to excuse yourself if you need to. This is definitely an open environment, so if you have any questions, by all means, feel free to ask at any time. At the end of our discussion today, I'll leave ample time for us to double check if there's anything, points of clarification, or something that you would like for me to redemonstrate again. I'd be happy to do that. If you look around the room, there is an agenda that I have as a handout. Go ahead and pull that out and take a look at it, please. Take about 30 seconds to look at the agenda. Okay. As you can see on the agenda, this is our guide today. It's our discussion topics in our presentation. First, we're going to start off with a couple of introductions. The room configuration is set up in a table format. There's chairs side by side where there can be discussions, one-on-one, group work activity, etc. And our discussion topic today that we're looking at is if employer insurance should cover the cost of plastic surgery. Should employer insurance cover the cost of plastic surgery? We're going to first start off by defining what exactly plastic surgery is. Obviously, things come to mind out of what we see on television, what we see in the media. And there's also, to the flip side, plastic surgery that could be beneficial to someone. So we're going to look at both sides, and throughout our demonstration today, think of where you fall, where your perspectives are on the topic. As I mentioned, plastic surgery can be both cosmetic, and also we'll learn of a term called reconstructive. If you want to write that one down, reconstructive, we'll explore what exactly that means. We'll look at employee insurance provisioning. What are some of the coverage rules they have active in place today that allows them to cover certain procedures? And do they have to cover any procedures at all, even if it's in the benefit of the patient? We'll have a couple of brainstorming sessions. There's a video I want to show you, some group discussions, some group activities, and towards the end of our discussion, we'll do a brief summary. So as you can see, our strategy today is rather blended versus having me here ramble on and on, because trust me, I can do that. I'll try my best to kind of break it down and keep everybody engaged. And just one quick note, everyone's time is valuable. I'll try very hard to keep us on track. And although there might be differences in opinions, thoughts, the foundation of our discussion today is respect, mutual respect towards one another. We may not all agree on the same topic. Nonetheless, I encourage the dialogue, discussion, just be mindful of others. Now, before I dive into the topic, on the dry erase board, I wrote down a couple of things that I first want to get to know you first. So I want you to take a moment and in front of you, there is a name tent. Go ahead and take the name tent and the marker that I placed in front of you, and you can just fold it in half and write down your name, because your name is very important to me that I know as we have our discussion. Alrighty, thank you very much for doing that. Very briefly, as you're putting your name tent, you got it, just like that, you're good.
I got it.
Thank you, Mike. Alright, I knew you could make it through with the name tent. Something I brought with us in the room today, because this discussion is interactive and to keep everybody engaged, you'll notice that around the room I've set up, in addition to the agenda, the name tent, markers, pens, and pencils for you to write with, all the materials you need to stay engaged, I also brought some creative, unique toys. And you're probably thinking, well, why the toys in this discussion? These aren't just any toys. These toys are meant to keep you engaged. Now, I'm going to ask for some feedback if I may. I'll ask for a question. May I do that?
Sure.
Okay, so take a moment and think, why would we have some kind of toys in the room? And then feel free to share with me your feedback. No right or wrong answers, obviously.
I don't know.
I don't know, okay.
I've been sitting here looking at them going, what in the world are we using these for?
They truly don't serve a specific, no, thank you for that, excellent. They simply don't serve a unique purpose towards our discussion on topic per se. But are you familiar with the word multitasking?
Yes.
Studies show that in our culture, everyone tends to be doing more than one thing at one time. And I tend to be that person. If I'm working email, I'm doing something with my pen, or I'm on my app on my phone while I'm looking at a browser. So with that in mind, the mind becomes more engaged. As you're thinking about something, where you fall on a topic, you can grab a toy and just fiddle with it, play with it. If you're really not sure, it'll help. The thought process there is that it'll help you expand your mind and help you stay engaged. Others may disagree with that, and that's completely okay. Nonetheless, it always works well to bring toys into the room, especially in a discussion in which we want to have fun with it. We want to keep it engaged and talking. Very good. Now that everyone has the supplies that I passed out before we started and the room is set up, we know where the bathrooms are at. I want to get to know you first. And I'll model what I'm looking for, and then you can follow the example in our introduction. I'm going to give you my name. You know, it's Abraham Hernandez. You're welcome to call me Abe. My profession is I deliver presentations on behalf of the organization that we're all with today, the UNT School of Systems. And aside from that profession, that's just my profession from a business standpoint. I'm also a father. I have a 2-year-old little girl. Her name is Zicky. She's a Minpin. Love her to death. And I'm also a brother. I have family. I'm from the state of Texas. And I'm really happy to be here with you today to go over this topic. My favorite cereal, there's several healthy cereals out there today, right, that I could go on and on about. But when I was a child, I always liked Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Now, I came from a family that money wasn't always available, so that was always a bit of a challenge to have Cinnamon Toast Crunch unless you got the knockoff, right? But that was my favorite cereal. So take a moment. I'm going to give you 1 minute. I'm going to time it and fill out this on your paper.
Thank you.
Okay, alrighty. Who would like to go first? All right, Mike, thanks so much. So Mike, go ahead and introduce yourself, please.
All right, so my name is Mike Zuckerman, go by Mike. Profession, I'm a full-time student, formerly active duty military, retired now. As far as my favorite cereal, that would actually have to be Count Chocula. Similar background, you know, it was one of those. Money wasn't always plentiful, and anytime we get our hands on the monster cereals, as they were called, that was a big deal. So, and honestly, who didn't just pick out the marshmallows and leave the actual grainy cereal for the rest of the family? That was the favorite thing to do in my house.
Yeah. Alrighty. Well, good to meet you. Good to have you here, Mike. So, in your profession, you work with military staff, is what you?
No, I'm retired.
Oh, you retired? Okay.
I left them all behind.
Alrighty. Okay. Alright. Well, thanks for taking the time to be here with us today. Very good. So now that we have the introductions out of the way, I briefly want to emphasize that We know what our subject is today as it relates to plastic surgery, but something that our discussion is not is, it's certainly not for us to explore what kind of cosmetic surgery we could get as individuals. There's always that temptation, right, as we'll see as we get through the paperwork. It's neither judgment on others that perhaps have obtained plastic surgery and they may disclose that, or, you know, those that we know, family members, friends. And it's certainly not a venting session on a past negative experience we've had with any kind of surgical procedure. Just a kind reminder to always remain respectful towards one another in our discussion. So let's begin with a brief brainstorming session. What exactly is plastic surgery? In front of you, there's a pen, paper. I'd like for you to take 1 minute to write down as many things that come to your mind. There's no right or wrong answers as far as plastic surgery goes, and then I'm going to map your information on our board. Okay, we'll give it about another 10-15 seconds. Okay. So, Mike, if I may, please share with me, what are some of the items that you wrote down that came to mind what our plastic surgery is?
First thing popped in my head was fake boobs.
Fake boobs, okay, we'll put...
Not to be crass,
not
but seriously, the first thing I always think of.
Fake. Well, if I may, can I write it down as breast implant?
That's a fine.
Okay, very good. Fake breast implant. Okay. What else?
Tummy tuck.
A tummy tuck. Oh, yeah.
This is not my personal list, by the way. This is just liposuction.
Liposuction.
And then when I got to the end of those three, the first thing that popped in my mind with that short list was self-gratification.
Self-gratification.
Make me feel good about me.
That's an interesting point, self-gratification.
And then I took a different route as I was brainstorming. There's an organization I used to donate to called Operation Smile,
okay,
which is a charitable organization that will provide free plastic surgery for children who are born with disfigurements of the face so they can feel like other children and not be picked on.
Okay.
So it was Operation Smile or facial reconstruction.
There we go. Interesting. So, thank you for the feedback. Anything else?
No, just in that same realm, just, you know, fixing people after an accident or a horrible disfigurement so they can fit in with society, because we are very visual as a society. It's all about how you look.
This is very good feedback, and I appreciate it, Mike. It obviously gives us two sides to the story, doesn't it?
Yep.
On the left, what first came to mind was the fake breast, the tummy tuck, the liposuction, the self-gratification. I like how this was the last one, because it really brought this all into what it really is. Because in our culture, in American culture, when we're watching TV, when we're at the supermarket in line, we see the magazines and the tabloids, there's always something in our culture about what comes to mind with plastic surgery. But on the flip side, the facial reconstruction, the self-esteem based on the Operation Smiles, which, by the way, must have been an amazing experience.
No, I really just donated to them, but I wanted to pick a charity that I thought meant something to somebody else. I mean, we can give to Ducks Unlimited or one of these crazy organizations and Save the Spotted Owl, but too many children grow up in this world with facial deformity and they're picked on, they're ridiculed, and they don't really get a chance to just live a normal life that the rest of us get to experience. So, to me, giving $10, $20, $50, whatever I was giving at the time, to me was worth it. Because I can't even imagine one of my children being different from one of the others. I've been blessed that both my children look somewhat normal.
Absolutely. I have seen on Discovery Channel or National Geographic, the in foreign countries, children that have the lip, you know.
Exactly.
Special, and there's doctors that go, Doctors Without Borders that go and help. So. So at the end of the day, in our culture, we think of plastic surgery mostly. It's the first things that came to mind.
The negative connotations.
The negative connotations. Yeah. And on the flip side, there is a quality of life that can increase, not only for children, but for anyone who perhaps has experienced an accident, a fire, who I think we can all relate, being employees of an organization, if we do work for a certain corporation, there could be accidents in a refinery. A lot of my family worked in the refineries in South Texas, and fires happened there all the time. And the question here to ask us is, where do our employee insurance, because obviously in America, all of us, for the most part, obtain our insurance through an employer-sponsored benefit, or with healthcare reform, which is another controversial demonstration all of its own.
Next week's lecture.
Next week's lecture. With healthcare reform, we have the exchanges also that we could go to and obtain coverage that way. In a minute, we're going to explore where our employers and where the federal government falls within this surgery. But very briefly, I'd like for you to review, and I don't have an overhead in this room. Nonetheless, as a plan B, I brought this mini little pad.
Okay.
You want to take about a minute, just scroll through that.
Just scroll down the
screen. Yeah, just scroll down the screen. It's a list of most common plastic surgeries in America.
Is this in any particular order or just a
random? No, just exactly. Okay. It's just a layout of the most common. And we'll have some dialogue after the review.
Ooh, hair replacement. Didn't even think of that one. Because that's been a big one too, and I don't even think of that one as a plastic surgery.
Hey, Mike, I have a question, please. And you can leave the laptop.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm going to show you the laptop in just a moment again. Okay. So based on the list, was the list similar to what you came up with on your own?
Most of it was all on that left side.
Exactly. And that's in our culture, right? So even when we think of plastic surgery and when we review a professional website, medical website of what the common procedures are, that's what's common. Now, I also want to show you very briefly, and I would broadcast this on the overhead. I'm on this very brief video. It's plastic surgery in a country where South Korea, where medical facilities don't have available to them at their fingertips, all the latest technology, doctors and whatnot. So I'm going to show you this video. And think of it as you're looking at this video, think of the list you just also looked at as well.
This hospital sees 25,000 patients each year. Its patients include burn victims from both Korea and abroad. This Chinese patient will receive his final surgery today. He suffered burns to his entire face after an accident at work. The burn left his face unrecognizable, but after more than 10 surgeries, his face is slowly regaining its original appearance.
Objective of burn plastic surgery is to help burn patients return to everyday life. More confident, aesthetically pleasing reconstruction.
Burn injuries to the face can lead to psychological trauma. In such cases, reconstructive surgery that also takes aesthetic factors into account is especially helpful.
After we examine the amount of muscle and nerve damage to determine whether recovery is possible, we perform reconstructive procedures with the viable muscle and tendons.
This Mongolian patient recently completed his surgery. The patient, who is a fireman, was rushed to this hospital after suffering burns over 60% of his body while fighting a fire.
He started to do everyday activities.
Did it repeat itself?
No. He started rehab therapy. So much better.
Korea's burn plastic surgery techniques continue to help patients around the world each day.
Okay.
Initial review of the video, comparison to the list. What were your thoughts, if I may ask, on what you saw in the video versus the list?
Well, this is more beneficial. This goes on the other side of the coin where this isn't about making them feel better. This is about returning them to a status prior to an accident or an injury.
It makes them feel better, like you mentioned. So
it does. I mean, it in a way, it's self-gratification, but it's almost just to be functional in everyday society, because when we see someone who is horribly burned, the automatic reaction is to recoil or move away from them. We're not comfortable with it because they don't have the polished appearance that the rest of us might.
We're conditioned that way, aren't we? That makes perfect sense. So to help narrow it down, you explained it perfectly. On the left, we could think of this as cosmetic purposes, which based on feedback today, could have self-gratification. With that, I'm thinking self-esteem, our self-respect, etc. And then there's also the reconstructive procedures, which as we've seen, could be life-sustaining. In America, employer insurance policies have a discretionary rule when it comes to the coverage they provide for either or procedures, which means they don't have to, or it means that they could if they wanted to. As we're learning, reconstruction and cosmetic are vastly different. They, nonetheless, within the eyes of the insurance providers, fall within the realm of plastic surgery. Take a moment and, using your pen, write down at least three thoughts of where you stand on that. Okay. Do you mind sharing what you came up with, please?
Sure.
Thank you.
I do believe insurance should cover with the following criteria. One would be the psychological effect of why they need the surgery. I know in your outline you've got wants versus needs. I'm going to touch on that a little bit, maybe ahead of the game, but wanting breast implants, tummy tuck, for whatever reason, that is, in most cases, not as psychologically damaging as, say, the fireman in your video, whose face was completely demolished. I mean, it didn't even look like a face anymore, except for one eye looked somewhat normal. So based on the psychological effect of what is desired with that consultation of a therapist or a psychiatrist, then, yeah, I would say that would be the impetus to making the surgery happen. Any surgery that helps someone return to normal as the criteria, such as facial reconstruction, those type of situations, I would say definitely provide the surgery at insurance expense. If we just can't burn off those last 5 pounds, sorry, that's just not psychologically damaging enough personally. And there are multiple methods to doing that. I'm a big fan of a lot of these extreme makeover shows where they get these people in the course of a year.
I've seen those, yeah.
And I love the guy who does it, Chris Powell, shrinks these people down from 400, 500 pounds. Mm. But then there is that extra skin. The body creates this extra skin. It stretches out. That's got to go. To me, that is part of that psychological process to return to a normal state. They did the hard work to earn that place. Now let's do the surgery at the expense of the insurer to finish the job. They've proven they're in for the end process.
Absolutely.
So rather than carry this extra meat around that they can't use, let them have that.
I get that. And everything you shared, there was aspects of both sides to the story. So at the end of the day, if we were to summarize it, there really truly is two sides, the reconstruction, the needs versus wants, the cosmetic purposes. Go ahead.
Well, because even in the fake breast, the breast augmentation, I mean, breast cancer is a huge, huge problem right now. And look, if they have to do a hysterectomy, or a mastectomy, sorry, mastectomy, I'm thinking different surgeries.
Confusing genders.
But if they have to do a breast removal to prevent someone from dying from breast cancer, preventing the spread to the rest of their body, I think the return to normal factor comes in to breast augmentation.
Makes sense.
I mean, honestly, for a woman, breasts are an identifier.
I get that. And I do want to, obviously, touch on the other side of the, because I'm not taking sides on either or, I'm just trying to facilitate both perspectives. And I appreciate the feedback, absolutely. You mentioned earlier how, you know, the leftover skin of someone who's trying to lose weight, there are people that say that they feel psychologically damaged by that. And then on the flip side, and I'm not agreeing or disagreeing with that perspective, on the flip side, the self-esteem portion, the fake breasts that were lost due to cancer could just as be hold just the same amount of an argument. So there truly is both sides, and I appreciate the feedback. So when we summarize this today, American culture thinks of plastic surgery as purely cosmetic. The actual procedure of plastic surgery covers reconstruction as well as cosmetic. Employee insurance have a discretionary coverage rule to either cover based on situations. They're not required to cover reconstructive surgery, even if it's life-sustaining. And we also learned, neither we agreed or disagreed, that from a cosmetic standpoint, there is the argument that some individuals may feel that the cosmetic purposes may be life-sustaining for them as well. We have heard of suicides in the news because of some of these related.
And this is where that psychological effect comes in. With that psychological evaluation, it's easy to sit down in front of a doctor and go, hey, I want a smaller tummy. I want a bigger chest. I want more of a rear end. It's another thing to sit down in front of a psychiatrist and say, I can't function. I can't wake up. I can't look at myself in the mirror because I hate who I see. And yeah, when you start looking at the suicide effect, or, I mean, what's the value of that?
Exactly. Well, I'd like to thank you, in summary, for attending today's discussion. I think we uncovered a lot of perspectives that we don't normally think about on a daily basis, right, when it comes to plastic surgery. And there truly is two sides to the story. And the next step is to find out where we fall as individuals on the topic. And when we're applying for our next year's benefit coverage for insurance, either through the exchanges or through employers, certainly a question that should be asked. Were there any other questions?
No.
Thanks again so much for your participation.
Not a problem.